Vice Chairman of the Conservation Committee of the Nature Society of Singapore, and he's also a council member of the society. He has been involved in conservation projects for the society as a volunteer since the late 80s, and projects he has been involved in include the formulation of the Sungai Buloh conservation proposal and the master plan for nature conservation in Singapore. So today, he's going to talk to us about the ecological and biodiversity importance of Bukit Brown, and he has studied the area for a long time. So after several decades of wild vegetation growth, after the cemetery was degazetted, a lot of wildlife has moved into the area, especially forest bird life. So he's going to focus on that for the talk. Okay, Dr. Ho, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The information I'm going to present here, the data, is actually the result of the efforts of the bird group of the Nature Society over the decades. So it's just not my what I call personal observation, things like that. But of course, the focus is really on the bird life in Bukit Brown. Right? So what I will be telling you all may overlap. Wasn't around this year. What Win Chong has presented in Chinese yesterday. So I hope you don't mind. If you have been around yesterday, I hope you can bear with it. Alright.
The last one.
Okay, so so start out with this master plan for the conservation of nature submitted to the government, formulated in 1919. In that master plan, I just want to tell you that Bukit Brown is already featured in that master plan. That's one of the 80 nature areas that we recommend to the government for conservation. But of course, at that time, we were quite new to Bukit Brown. Anyway, so that was in the 1990. So, I mean, we do not get much about the bird life there. Right, so, in that document, sort of classified as a two-star area out of five. Okay. So after more than a decade or so, we become more knowledgeable, more aware of the richness of the bird life of the brown. And of course, this is due to the fact that you know the vegetation there, the woodland, have matured over the years and have attracted more wildlife to the area. So the latest update we have is around 2011, 2012. So things are definitely better. And we have classified it as a 4-star area. So it is basically a woodland ecosystem, right? With a size of 233 hectares. And this includes area, the stretch of forest that is adjacent to the police academy, I think what they call Kopi Swa. Maybe that's a newer part of the cemetery. Alright, it's basically a tree designated by NPARC. Alright, it's a tree conservation area. Alright, the boundary is Dunyan, Whitling, Mount Pleasant, Thompson, Bombay Road, PI, in 1991. Right. Of course, tree conservation area just entail that you know you cannot just simply lock off, cut off any tree that is 1 meter in curve, maybe half a meter or 1 meter above the ground level without the permission of the commissioner of parks and recreation. So if a government wants to lock off the area, or if a private owner of the land wants to lock off the tree, old tree, alright, they have to seek the permission of the Commissioner of Parks and Recreation. And if we give the permission, it's legitimate. Then we cut it. So, in a way, it's not a very strong legal status for the conservation of the area as a whole, as a kind of a natural habitat. We're going to preserve most or all of the vegetation in the area, whether it is heritage tree or old trees and so on. We want to preserve for us a habitat. Alright? So this is not adequate to cover the protection of the area. So, we have recommended it in our master plan. and in 1999, we have also emphasized its important in our feedback for the Inter-Ministerial Committee project on Sustainable Singapore, a lively, livable city. And of course, throughout the years, we have conducted field trips for our members, for the public, on a quite a regular basis. Not every month, but about three or four occasions a year, to do bird watching in the evening. So the Nature Society is quite familiar with the place. All right, so this is the map of the area that we're talking about, 233 hectares. All right. Okay, so most people are familiar with the whole area, the main portion, but the area south of Mount Pleasant is what we are also interested in, and it's in a way quite very peaceful, very quiet, and surprisingly, it's a very thick patch of forest somewhere on the east of On Ring Road. It is contiguous to the private bungalows, right, just behind the police academy, prison somewhere. Okay. Now, when Bukit Brown was established as a cemetery, when Bukit Brown was established as a cemetery, obviously the whole area is completely bare. If you look at the old topo map, it's completely barren, apart from grasses, horticultural shrubs, dotted by the varieties of date. And I suppose that was over 50 years ago. Right? And so now you see that the whole place has been completely transformed. Alright, it's completely green all over. And if you have a helicopter view from top, alright, it looks like a dense forest with a canopy quite tight. Alright. So we can say that this is not exactly, from an overall point of view, exactly a scrubland, so to speak. I would say that it is, if you like, a woodland, this is just subtle differences. You like a new secondary forest, a secondary forest, a young one that's emerging in this area. From, of course, a grassy area to a scrubland, and finally, woodland forest. Okay. So, yes, it has been completely transformed over the decades because of, neglect. The government deconsented it as a cemetery, and then only a few relatives look after some of the graves. Most of it are more or less left neglected or abandoned. So wild vegetation invaded the area, and of course, from everywhere, but it has slowly been transformed into a kind of forest because of some of the vegetation that are coming in from the central catchment nature reserve, right, from the Mechachie Forest, which is directly opposite Lornier Road, or on the other side of Bukit Brown, across Lornier Road. Right. So let's make it now a very valuable habitat, right, for wildlife, especially bird. Okay, so this one kind of habitat you can see there. Marshy area. Not completely marshy on the upper slope, but there is a stream that moves down from here all the way down to Chinkana area. I call it a stream, but I should not say that, but because it's actually a monsoon drain. A small, shallow monsoon drain. It, of course, cement embankment, but it has been away overwhelmed by sediment, where the bottom of the drains, of course, sediment, a lot of sediment, mud, with what you call reeds, aquatic vegetation moving in from the pan. So the whole place looked, in a way, I wouldn't say natural, but semi-natural, greenery. So a kind of semi-natural stream and marshy ground has been established all the way down to Jim Town. Alright, so this is another connected to the one that we showed earlier. And obviously you can see that it's not very natural, just very straight. Right? Okay. There is, of course, it's a drain. The embankment is still there at the bottom. But mud sediment have accumulated. And the sides are very marshy. Certain part, I think the water has spread out and become very marshy. So this is one kind of habitat. Alright, of course, freshwater stream, whether it is, I mean, natural or semi-natural, is pretty rare in Singapore. You can only find it mostly in the central catchment forest, Bukit Timong. And the outside central catchment is very hard to find this kind of habitat. And of course, freshwater life, right, found in this area. And surprisingly, in the stream that was shown earlier, you can have, you know, a shoal of the common bark, saddle bark, right, in the upper part of the stream. In saddle bark, you know, common bark, very common bark, is a fish species that you usually found in heavily forested stream. So surprisingly, they are found missing. It could be that it is a colony that have survived. They have moved out from the Makachi Forest stream there, moved into the Bukit Brown stream and have survived. So they're still there, right? And of course, you have other freshwater life like common snakehead, wager, which can be also very uncommon in Singapore. And also things like terapin, the box, million box terapin is found there in this stream. And other fish life. Box terrapin also, they're about getting uncommon. Okay. Alright, this is another kind of habitat, which is, I think, here is from Kopi Swan, okay, here at Police Academy. And, it is a newer cemetery, so it's barer, with little less dense vegetation. And, it's a typical, you can call it grassland or scrubland. See, this part is all grassland. And slowly the whole area is transformed into scrubland. Right. Scrubland, yeah, is made where you have shrubs, isolated trees, cluster of trees, standing amidst a stretch of very grassy, wild, grassy area. So you can call it scrubland or grassland. So it has been transformed definitely into grassland. And after that, one succession, right, it will become a woodland forest. Okay. Now, this sort of habitat, of course, in a way, is not uncommon. It's common in many areas, newly established reclaimed land, where grasses sprout out spontaneously. After a time, you have shrubs, isolated trees coming up, albizia, acacia sprung up, or even gazolina along the coast, okay, scrubby areas, and in other parts of Singapore as well. But of course, it's important for certain kind of wildlife, for birds. Birds that prefer a more open landscape, like the bunyas, right? Seed-eating grassland birds, bunyas, right? Scaly-breasted bunyas, white-headed bunyas, things like that. Baya weavers, too, they like to come open like that. And the lesser kuka, too, right? I mean, the tribe will start having that. And we will say that scrubland is of no use because they are common. You can fill up or destroy all the scrubland, have settlement, housing estate, factories. Then all these scrubland birds will have nowhere to go. You cannot expect them to retreat into the woodland, into the mangrove, into the forest. Let's say we have a nature reserve. we can peel up all these, what they call, grassy area, you know, and birds will fly elsewhere. Where else to go? Into the central catchment? No. So if we just have the central catchment alone, all right, minus the marshland, mangrove, scrubland, grassland, that will not do. Your total biodiversity for the whole of Singapore will definitely go down. Okay? Because central catchment can only preserve your forest plants. Conserve your forest plants. So this is some forest scene inside the forest. Here, this road, the on-road road, where the Coast Academy. This is one part of Bukit Brown, less frequented, but be careful where you go in. There's a kind of hut, right, for the grave undertakers. And there are a lot of ferocious dogs there. So you go in, they will come and charge you. 10, 20 dogs there, guarding that little hut there. Okay. So another forest scene. Okay, this has become very famous. Well known in Singapore because they've been the cover of Nature Watch. We have extra copies of Nature Watch. This is a cover. So Kok Peng is holding it, and your copies are here. All right. Okay. By the way, we have here Kok Peng. I forgot to mention our deputy president and chair of the conservation committee, and we have Ho Swin Chong. And here in front of me, Alan Aoyong, ex-chair of the urban group. So if you have any question, these people can always respond on my behalf. Okay, so now, of course,
I mean, Bukit Brown is becoming more and more natural, like more and more wild. Reason for saying this is because a lot of wild vegetation, plants, have colonized the area. So it is not a place where you just have what they call a horticultural plant, plants that were originally planted, okay, there by our government or by relatives of the team.
Things like the main tree, of course, is planted, and some of the beautiful horticultural shrubs to decorate the creek. These are all planted vegetation. But over the years, wild plants have gone in and established themselves, you know, all over. Proliferation of wild plant. So the whole place is becoming more and more natural. So becoming, I can say, from grassland, scrubland, woodland now to secondary forests. Right? Early stages of secondary forests. Okay? And the indications I'll show you, a couple of indicators. This, of course, the banyan tree, either Ficus ninjamina or Ficus madocarpa. These are all natural plants. They are there on their own account. Fruit seeds and all that. What are the birds? Go for the seeds, fruits. And there are many all over there. Okay. And of course, very important for bird life. The fruits, when ripe, attract all kinds of birds. Copper skin barbell, boo-boos, pigeon, and so on. And it proliferates all over Bukit Brown. And provide a lot of shade too. Right? A dense canopy for a lot of forest birds. Alright, another one. Wild vegetation. The Albizia. Right? Okay, growing all over the place. So, this is a wild plant. Although not native to Singapore, right? I think brought here cultivated for plantations for wood pulp, maybe by the Japanese colonizer or the British, but originated from East Malaysia, from Borneo all the way to the Solomon Island, but not native to Singapore or the Malay Peninsula. But very important plant, although not of local, right? It forms a habitat for butterflies, for tree snakes, and birds. right? Nesting ground for our local resident eagles. All right? Pretty important. I'll talk about it more later. Okay, another alvisia. Okay, now, this is the giant mama. Proliferating here. And if you go to Lonnie Road, walk along Lonnie Road, you'll see that if you walk towards the Thompson, on the right is Lonnie, the Bukit Brown, on the left is the handkerchief forest. So you'll see line up on the Bukit Brown side, along the edge of the road, by the roadside, a whole row of this giant maha, okay, makaranga species, all along the edge of Bukit Brown. So what it shows is that this plant, a wild plant, a forest plant, because it's not a forest plant of the deep jungle, right? But of a secondary jungle forest, right? And move over from the Makriji side. And the first stage, where the land will be along the roadside, nearer to the roadside, where the housing estate is. So you see a lot of them lining up there. And they are moving further and further into the interior of Bukit Brown. Right? And so they are actually widespread over Bukit Brown. So a forest species, right? Not a hardcore forest species like the Dictoroka, but a forest species of the secondary forest species, and move over and colonize Bukit Brown. As assemblies themselves there. A close-up view of the Makaranga, broadly. Alright, this is the last one, the Tarantam. Alright, another forest species. Not a hardcore forest species, secondary forest. And they have also moved over and slowly spreading all over Bukit. They have long leaves. Right? So, basically, I mean, there are more, but I'm not a plant expert. But these two species indicate that Bukit Brown is slowly being transformed into a secondary forest. Maybe at an early stage. Right? I would call it like what you see maybe in Mankuchi, those secondary forests in Mankuchi, they are very old. Maybe over 70 years to 100 years old. The oldest tree is about 400 years old. But some of the outlying area in the central catchment maybe about 70 old. Less than 150, but this definitely over 50 years old. So slowly becoming a forest. So it's a good sign, right? All right. So basically, I mean, we're interested. This place is a huge area, 203 acres, for what we now say secondary forest. The concern. For not just the biodiversity, but also for the sort of ecosystem services that it can provide. And I'm sure you all are quite familiar with all this carbon sequestration, right? Basically, I mean, the botanist can tell you that trees are pretty good in sort of storing up carbon CO2 because of the hardwood. The bigger the trees, the older the trees, more carbon are sequestered. Right. The carbon in the leaves, yeah, carbon in the leaves, all right, but the leaves crop. And when it decay, the CO2 is released. But when the CO2, carbon is locked up in the tree trunk and the woody branches, it is locked up more on a more permanent basis. Okay. Of course, mangrove too. Is good for carbon storage. Good because it occurs in wet conditions. So when the leaves drop from the mango trees and the branch break and drop into the mud, and the mud cover it up, water cover it up, carbon is not readily released into the air. So it is over time, you know, locked up in the mud and become eventually peat. Things like that. So forests, because of the dominant of three species with a lot of woody structures, very important for carbon sequestration. So if you destroy it, burn it, and whatever, you will release this carbon back into the air. And I talked to some botanists, because we destroy a lot of forests, a lot of carbon is released, and we do a lot of planting. But all the planting we do all over the world will not replace the carbon storage that comes with established forests that have been destroyed. No matter what you do, you cannot bring back that tonnage of carbon storage in old forests. You can plant trees here and there along roadside, here and there along the housing estate, HDB. But if you clear a patch of forest to establish that housing estate, you cannot, the planting cannot replace the carbon that's already taken out from the air and put on hold in the wood. You see? Of course, in the forest, trees will topple, thunderstorm, branches will break. But this is not a massive scale, right? Of course, when trees topple, carbon can be released because when they deteriorate, decay, biodegrade, you know. But this is on a very small scale here and there. As long as the whole forest is intact, the carbon is there. So, see. But we clear everything, all right, and home has to be released. Okay. Natural air conditioner, of course, this is the, what you call, it has a cooling condition, sort of mitigate the, what you call, urban heat island effect. Due to the present, massive presence of concrete, all right, and clearing of forest, more concrete coming up, more heat generated trap, and there's not enough what they call, what water is called, the leaf index, all right, the volume of leaf index with the presence of forest is lost. So the greater the leaf index, better it is to sort of generate the cooling of the ambient temperature due to evapotranspiration going on in the air. Okay. And of course, forests are not mentioned here. I think a lot of you know that it's good to sort of act as a kind of a sponge, you know, to sort of suck up particles. Air particles, dirt in our atmosphere, in our air, like haze, for example. The leaves and all that can trap all these dust particles. Alright. And of course, it's good as a rainfall sponge. Right? When rain comes down, the leaves and all that will act as a sponge to hold the water, the raindrops. Of course, some of the raindrops will percolate down the branches through the trunk and to the ground. But it slows down the percolation, the downfall of the rain through the ground. And slows down the water runoff into the drain and canal. So in a way, it helps to sort of mitigate flooding, prevent flooding or mitigate flooding. Okay. All right, so, well, I mean, these things are put into our city biodiversity index formulated by NPARKS, MND NPARKS, for the UN, you know, and has been accepted as a manual for sustainability worldwide. Okay, the emphasis of that manual is on carbon storage, cooling effect of vegetation, regulation of water. So here, so we formulate this city biodiversity index for use by the UN, recognized by the UN, and recommended for use for any country. So I think we should take seriously this ecosystem services, because we have emphasized it in this biodiversity index, which we are all very proud of. And of course, this form part of the UN Convention on Biological Diversity, right, which is ratified in 1995. So, well, I mean, we subscribe to this index, and we want it to be promoted and used by all nations. We should set an example by trying to sort of preserve whatever woodland, forest, greenery we have, because of this function. Okay. All right. So in terms of the wildlife, of course, it is also very important. I mean, personally, for me, it doesn't matter whether the area is rich in wildlife or not. So long as you have a forest, all right, big forest, it is worth protecting, even though there's hardly any wildlife. Although it's not rich in wildlife, because of the ecosystem services, keep it. Even if it's new or young, let it grow and develop into a mature forest. And sooner or later, the wildlife will appear. Right? From the central catchment forest, or from the north, Malaysia, Malay Peninsula, they will move down and colonize Singapore. I mean, given that they are all you know, look at Johor. Most of the tropical rainforest is finished. Right? Okay, so in terms of biodiversity, it's pretty important too. 94 resident migrant species, with 25% of the total species in Singapore, which come to 376 species, the latest checklist in 2011. So 15 of these are in the Singapore Red Data Book. The whole list here. Okay, and some of these are forest species. Species that are dependent on the forest habitat. So, okay. Okay, so for the forest species, let's look at the forest species. Basically, if you look at the, should have met better, at the, at the northern part of Bukit Brown, of course the road transect would be here, this is the one. The Central Catchment Nature Reserve is here, and this stretch is called the Mukuchi Forest. South of the Mukuchi Reservoir, which is an open area, water body. And if you look at the Mukuchi Forest, right, south of the reservoir there, you find that it is a very small area, elongated, narrow, right? And of course to the north is the reservoir itself. So we see that this place is becoming isolated. It's an isolated forest habitat. Okay, to the right is actually the golf course, Cyber Golf Course. Sorry, to the left here, and then to the right is the dam area. It is very open, built up, and full of people. North water body. So this is a very small habitat. The forest wildlife here, I believe, find it too crowded. The carrying capacity for some of the species, I think, has been exceeded. Forest species. That's why we see the forest species moving into this area. And they move to this area because they know that this area is becoming more and more forested, all right? So they find it attractive to come down. If it's just scrubland, the forest species will not come over to forage for food or to have nests, see? So these are the forest species you can see here. Things like that. It has become an extended foraging range habitat for forest species. 48 of them, huh? About 50 of the total at Bukit Brown has been found at Bukit Brown. Okay. So why valid? I'll show you some pictures. So basically what this means is that this area will be transformed into a forest. This area is very small. The forest bird find it hard to move northward into the larger part of the central catchment because of the big reservoir. Forest bird, most of them don't fly high and far. except the eagles, pigeon, and parrots, parakeets. Most of them are flying at undergrowth level, from scrub to scrub, or from undergrowth to undergrowth. Some of them just creep, hop. So you see a big stretch of reservoir, they won't cross. So they cannot get to the north, which is where the larger part of the central catchment nature reserve is. They can expand north, but they can't out because they're blocked. To the right, to the left, or the west, the golf course, too open. To the east, the dam area, too built up, too populated. I mean, too many people around. So the only way, what they have to take, the risk, some of them can fly across birds. You have to fly across one year old. Some of the birds can do it. 7 days, or just to survive. Even mammals, some of them, should be. So yeah, our sort of indirect study survey that we did, found that the concentration of forest bird is mostly along this northern stretch where the expressway will be run. So if you have the expressway, then there'll be no problem.
This is a mic.
Okay, yeah. All right. So if you leave it alone and when all area become forested, they move slowly, and slowly further down to the south. Okay, so it's very important. This is what I call the beachhead. So-called beachhead for forest species. Beachheads are very important. The first place where you land into enemy territory or inhospitable land, unknown territory. So the beachhead has to be secure first, has to be very secure before you can move further. Alright? But if the beachhead is destroyed, like you build this, and the forest bird will lose an opportunity to expand their territorial range, to expand their forest habitats. Okay. Right, so this is one example, white parrot woodpecker, especially when they extinct, okay, first found mainly in central catchment forest. Well, the most 4 or 5 birds were saved over the past 5 years or so. Nobody spot this bird anymore, this species. So it was found at Bukit Brown. So it means a typical forest species, hardcore, has moved to Bukit Brown, waiting for all the ants, insects found in dead trees, especially the albizia, dead albizia tree, packed at ants. But at this stage,
speed up a bit.
Okay, sorry. Okay, so another hardcore forest species, red crown barbear, black buzzard, changeable hawk eagle, and all that. These are all forest species. Here, I'm showing you here. Beautiful. Okay, spotted wood owl too, is recorded there. Alright, now we come to the changeable hawk eagle. This is a nest in Bukit Brown. Right, so changeable hawk eagle, forest species, is nesting in the area. And they like to nest in the albizia tree. Right, at Bukit Brown. Close up shot, but not taken at Bukit Brown. Sorry, not easy. Not easy to take a shot at the bird. Alright, just to say that, not only at Bukit Brown, in many other patches of woodland forest outside the nature reserve, this endangered species in the red litter group has colonized those patches and used those patches as nesting site. And most of the nesting sites are on albizia tree. So we have botanists have condemned albizia tree, but they are very important for our local endangered media. Alright. Not only the changeable hawk eagle, because they are alien, our local botanists not too happy to keep them. They prefer to cut it. And that's a bit local species. But local wildlife have got used to it. Kind of alternative habitat for the destroyed forests that exist long ago. So they got no choice. Because the albizia is the tallest tree around outside the nature reserve. And easy for them to build a nest. So not only this eagle, but the white-bellied sea eagle and the grey-headed fish eagle too, have used albizia trees for nesting. Okay, the grey-headed fish eagle, right, nesting on a museum, yeah, but not at Bukit Brown. But they are found at Bukit Brown, okay, quite regularly. Sorry, all right, now here, to show you that Bukit Brown is an important sort of takeoff point, okay, it's a kind of landing strip for forest wildlife, and also important base, takeoff point for Muslim birds, especially, to move further down along the various stepping stones all the way to the southern regions, the forest in the southern regions. They can move down here through Botanic Garden, MC Village, Potsdam, Alexandra Woods, Kent Ridge, Telok Blangah, and so on. Or they can take the other route through Malcolm Park, Bridge of Berlin, right? Way across the road, BIE, Malcolm Park, Goodwood Hill, Istana, Fort Canning, all the way down to the southern regions. These links are very important because the southern region, there are a lot of parks, right? And of course, there are woodland forests that exist along the slope which are not used for development. So, patches here and there, fragmented patches of forests exist along the slopes of all these parks. And there are forest bird life that still survive in those areas. But these are not actually the hardcore forest birds. Nevertheless, they are forest birds of the secondary forest, woodland. And their population is small. Over time, right, the biodiversity here, the population here, because of the degradation of the habitat here, fragmentation going on, is declining. So they need to be rejuvenated. All right? They cannot get rejuvenation from the south, from Indonesia, forest birds, because of the Straits of Singapore, big stretches of sea. All right? They don't like to travel long distance over non-forested area. So you can't get rejuvenation from the south, from Indonesia. The only way to rejuvenate is from Malaysia or from the Central Catchment Reserve. Malaysia, Central Catchment, through Bukit Brown, all the way. All right? So I'm talking about birds like olive-winged bubu, greater kukau, or even the lesser, what they call, blue-winged lip bird found here, it's a closer, and so on. These are actually forest-related birds. Not hardcore stuff, but you know, there's a small population here and there. They have to be rejuvenated. So, Bukit Brown is the first of the stepping stones, very important for this bird to push in the middle. Alright, so, touch that. Other wildlife, alright, of course, also important for, I mean, it's quite interesting. You have the Malayan Kelugo appearing there, surprisingly, despite the seven lane expressway, lorry road. They're able to come over, alright? This is recorded by a resident there. Then the Sunda pangolin, another forest species, both are forest species found there too. Butterfly, forest butterfly. Surprisingly, we have recently recorded the banded blind blue. New record for Singapore. And found only at Bukit Brown. Okay. Then the golden royal, endangered species of butterfly. So, of course, there are about 30 to 15 species of butterfly there. Right? And these are mammals. Okay, pangolin. And this is the one, okay, taken at Bukit Brown. Right? You can imagine that it make an effort. Only it was recorded, I think, the end of last year. Okay, from the Makuchi Forest, well, it goes to the tallest tree at the Makuchi Forest, and then it glided over Lonnie Road, seven lane expressway, and land at the edge near the housing estate. And it was seen by a resident who they photographed it. Okay, I mean, of course, there are, I think, more in the interior of Bukit Brown. And I suspect other things like Mausil, you know. So, it's a big challenge to glide over the seven-lane expressway. And the problem here is that if you have the new expressway created, even though you downsize the old Lonnie Road to a four-lane, right, some wildlife will be able to cross the four-lane. But when you have a new expressway created, eight-lane, will this wildlife species and other wilds be able to cross the 8-lane expressway, which is broader. 7-lane they will be able to glide across. 8-lane, I'm not too sure. And these cannot go under the expressway. They cannot crawl under the expressway like snakes. They have to glide. And about the other species, they glide. Other kind of squirrels too. Horsebill, flying squirrel. And a lot of gliders, lizards, flying lizards. So the bigger, the broader the expressway, the more problem they have. All right? Okay, so this is a golden royal. A hornbill from the forest, they move. Okay, some of the activities we see there. Yeah, that's the end. Thanks.